Whether for artistic or pragmatic reasons, pixel art is often authored for resolutions smaller than the screen they are ultimately displayed on. Upscaling to the display resolution is usually done using nearest neighbor point sampling, which keeps the pixels sharp, but can cause distracting aliasing artifacts when the scaling ratio is not a whole number, or if there's stretching or rotating effects, which are especially noticeable in motion. For conventional 3D assets, texture aliasing is usually mitigated by some combination of bilinear sampling, mipmapping, and anisotropic filtering, all of which are implemented directly on GPU hardware. While these filters do eliminate the aliasing, they also smear out the result in a way that's usually undesirable for pixel art assets. Ideally, what we want is to produce just enough filtering to eliminate aliasing while maintaining the original sharpness. In this video, we'll be developing a method which is able to display arbitrarily scaled, rotated, offset, and distorted pixel art textures without aliasing artifacts. I should also mention that this is all possible without any additional draw calls, VRAM usage, texture samples, or indeed any changes to the render pipeline. Initial research into this subject led me to this 2017 blog post by Cole Cecil describing a method for drawing pixel art at non-integer texel-to-pixel ratios. In this context, a texel, or texture element, refers to each square element in the texture, and a pixel, or picture element, refers to each square element in the render target, which we'll assume to be the screen. Broadly explained, when drawing a texture to screen, the texture's coordinate system, typically called its UVs, is transformed to the screen's coordinate system. This transformation is carried out through the polygons the texture is attached to. Each vertex of each polygon is associated with a UV coordinate, and when the GPU draws the polygon, the UVs at its vertices are interpolated to each pixel the polygon appears on in the screen. Then, inside a pixel shader, the UVs at each pixel are given to the sampler, which returns the texture color at that location, and the result is drawn to that pixel on screen. In general, the interpolated UVs at a pixel don't fall exactly on the middle of a texel, but typically fall somewhere between texels. Nearest neighbor sampling is so named because it returns the texel nearest to the sampled UV coordinate. Bilinear sampling is so named because it interpolates linearly between nearby texels, along one axis, then the other. If a pixel's UVs line up exactly with the center of a texel, bilinear sampling will result in returning the exact color of that texel. The method described in Cole's blog takes advantage of this fact by manipulating the UVs in the pixel shader before sampling. The UVs, which are normalized between 0 and 1, are first scaled to the texture size to get the texel coordinates. Then, the texel coordinates are snapped to the nearest texel center to produce a sharp sample, with an extra term to interpolate from the center of one texel to the next over a narrow band based on the ratio between pixel size and texel size. Finally, the texel coordinates are converted back to UVs and passed to the bilinear sampler to produce the final color. When the upscale ratio is a whole number and the image is placed pixel perfect on screen, the points evaluated by the pixel shader will just happen to dodge all of the interpolation regions, meaning no interpolation will be visible and the result will be a perfectly sharp upscale. This method works great for uniform scaling, and we can even extend it to support non-uniform stretching, which is done by making the upscale ratio a two-dimensional variable to separately handle the horizontal and vertical texture dimensions. However, it's not capable of handling more complex distortions, such as the perspective distortion from 3D rotations, which complicate what it means to calculate the upscaling ratio when texel shape and size varies across the image. In order to extend this method to cover these types of distortions, we'll first need a slightly deeper understanding of the problem. Bilinear sampling is often thought of as interpolation between the nearest four texels, but there's another way of explaining what it does. If we think of the texels as individual cells, each with its own solid color, the bilinear sample at a point is equal to the average color inside a single texel-sized box at that point. We can say that the bilinear filter is a type of box filter with a box size of a single texel, and we can use it to sample a box average at any texture location. Conceptually, to render with the ideal amount of anti-aliasing, we need to find the average texture color inside every pixel. And for that, we need a pixel-sized box filter. For example, to color this pixel, we we need to find the average texture color in this box. But there's a way to stretch the box, such that the average color contained within it doesn't change. If we stretch the box this way until it's the size of a texel, then we know from earlier that we can use the bilinear sampler to compute the average color in this box. And since we arrived at this box from our original pixel while carefully preserving the average color, that means the pixel color here is equal to the bilinear sample here. To render a pixel art texture with correct anti-aliasing, we just have to repeat this process on every other pixel. The shader code we had before was secretly already doing this. Or rather, this is just another way of thinking about what the code was doing. Instead of thinking about moving around the interpolation regions, we can think of this code as performing the calculations needed to compute some box average by converting it into a bilinear sample, and our shader works by passing in the ratio between the pixel and texel size to make the box into the size of a pixel. Now let's look at the problem from before again with this new perspective. When the texture is rotated, or distorted from perspective, we can't compute the box size directly from a pixel per texel ratio, because pixels and texels are no longer uniformly aligned. If we tried to compute the average color in a pixel now, the region of the texture contained within the pixel is no longer a rectangle, and the trick we used before of stretching the box into the size of a texel while preserving average color no longer works. Given that our stretching trick only works for axis-aligned rectangles, we can compromise by using the axis-aligned bounding box of our distorted pixel, which will be the smallest box filter that we can use to sample the texture using the bilinear sampler, while still providing enough anti-aliasing to cover the entire pixel. To compute this bounding box, we first need to compute the shape of the pixel in texture space. We know the shape of the pixel in pixel space is, by definition, a unit square. To transform it into texture space, we need to characterize the deformation of the texture space at the given pixel. Given that there are two pixel dimensions, xy, and two texture dimensions, uv, the deformation can be determined from four measurements: the change in u per x, the change in u per y, the change in v per x, and the change in v per y. These four rates of change define a 2x2 matrix, which I'll call the deformation gradient from pixel space to texture space. We can multiply the deformation gradient by any vector in pixel space to get the same vector in texture space. Expanding the matrix multiplication gives us a formula for solving UV vector components given XY vectors. If we evaluate this formula at the corners of a unit square, with XY components 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, and 0, 1, we get the texture space coordinates of the distorted pixel. To compute the width and height of the axis-aligned bounding box, we just need the difference between the maximum and minimum values of u and v. When we simplify this expression, we end up with the absolute value of du dx plus the absolute value of du dy for the texture space width, and the same expression with dv dx and dv dy for the texture space height. On the GPU, we can compute the four deformation terms using the ddx and ddy functions, and compute both the u and v box size in parallel. In fact, this operation is common enough that the shader language has a built-in function called fwidth that does the whole thing. Now that we're computing box size directly instead of the pixel per texel ratio, we can also simplify the sample offset code a bit. At this point, there are a few loose ends that remain to be tied up. First, the box size we calculate needs to be clamped to at most a single texel, because our box stretching trick assumes we don't cross any texel boundaries. The box size also needs to be larger than 0 because we don't want to divide by 0. Since the box size has to be smaller than one texel, there will be aliasing in situations where the desired filter amount is larger than one texel. To address this, we'll take advantage of the other two filtering methods, mipmapping and anisotropic filtering. Because of the way we've manipulated the UVs, the GPU's usual way of calculating how to apply these filters doesn't work reliably. To fix this, we just need to switch the sampling function to one that explicitly passes in the original UV's deformation gradient. Next, since our axis-aligned bounding box will tend to overestimate the amount of blurring required to perform anti-aliasing, We can purposefully compensate for this by using a slightly undersized box. Alternatively, what I prefer is to weigh the center of the box higher than the edges when computing the average color. If we choose a quadratic averaging window, the implementation turns out to be quite cheap to compute because integrating this window over a texel boundary results in a cubic transition, which can be directly computed using the smooth step function. Lastly, I want to address an issue that may show up when using bilinear sampling of color sprites with transparency. When a texture is encoded with straight alpha blending, where the image opacity is encoded independent of the image color, transparent texels have no well-defined color data, meaning that any box average that includes a fully transparent texel is not well-defined. Engines like Unity usually hide this problem by guessing the color of the transparent texels based on their surrounding opaque texels. But pixel art textures often contain regions where a transparent texel borders multiple different colored opaque texels, resulting in incorrect blending at these locations. The correct solution is to use pre-multiplied alpha blending, which is an alternative way of encoding transparency that bypasses this issue entirely by having well-defined color for transparent texels, while otherwise producing exactly equivalent results. In my own game, which is primarily polygon rather than sprite-based, I use the pixel art anti-aliasing method described in this video for upscaling the game's internal render resolution to the game's display resolution, as well as for UI and text elements that are drawn directly to the display. While this works optimally for integer upscaling, it also allows for less conventional upscaling ratios, such as when running in windowed mode. Ironically, none of my current use cases involve any of the rotating or 3D distortions discussed in this video, but I thought it was an interesting enough idea to fully develop, and I think it could potentially be a useful reference for others whose own design goals and use cases may differ from my own. To that end, for those who have expressed interest in supporting my work, I've opened an account on Patreon, where I plan on posting a bit more candidly about the upcoming content pipeline, as well as sharing some supplementary material to publish videos, such as source code examples or blog posts expanding on relevant ideas. To everyone else, thanks for watching.